belíssimo momento, sim. And estava looking into the history of all these festivals. I wanted to really know when it should end. And I actually found out that the harvest ends when the final cartload returns to the farm. And then they all share together in an harvest supper. That's when the harvest actually ends. And the only thing that's left to do after the harvest is gathered in, is the gleaning. And the act of collecting in all the leftovers, yes? And a job often done by the women, which actually signified the ending of the harvest. In Jeremiah 28, we read this. The people complained, and they said this: the spring and the summer has come and gone, but still the Lord hasn't rescued us. Or, in another version, says the harvest is past. The summer has ended, and we are not saved. And that was from God's own people, in acknowledgement of what was happening to them. I don't know if you know your salvation or the doctrines. I want to remind you of one particular one this morning, which says this: we believe as salvationists that the continuance in a state of salvation depends upon who can result at the last meeting. Continual obedient faith in Christ. We believe that if we are to remain saved, then we have to continue to be obedient to what the Lord asks of us. And so we're going to sing together: O thou God of full salvation, King of righteousness divine, author of the new creation, light of life within us shine, make us holy. Make us holy with thy blessings. Make us thine. There's four verses, and if you want to stand, we're going to sing the song of Stranger.
Thank you.
I wonder how God blesses you in your life. Often God blesses us through the opportunities that we are granted. You know, nothing in life has ever been done or accomplished without God's blessing of opportunity. And I'm sure this morning we can thank the Lord for the opportunities that have come our way. And sometimes we regret the opportunities we let go and we never took hold of them. But life itself is a gift of God. Though it's not always easy to live the life God has called us to live, but the opportunity to change our lives is always presented to us by God. And this is how God blesses us. So let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, your word says that you will always guide us. You do not leave us wandering through life, but you are with us during every moment of every day. You will satisfy our needs when we feel frustrated, and you will strengthen us when life makes us feel weary. Help us to follow your ways as you lead us into a life of fruitfulness and joy. May we be like the well-watered garden, which thrives because the roots are firmly planted in your love. So be with us, Lord, as we worship together and listen to your word, and help us to apply it accordingly. For we ask it in your name. Amen. We're going to sing again. Jesus, thy fullness give, my soul and body bless. Cleanse me from sin, that I may live the life of holiness. Cleanse me from sin, that I may live the life of holiness. We're going to sing every verse that we've got to this one, another four. So we're doing okay. And it's quite a jolly little tune, so if you feel and you want to keep moving, you can do, and we'll sing it right through. Thank you. You know, salvation is all about God. There's nothing we can do other than to be obedient and faithful to Him. Salvation belongs to God. And in Jeremiah 8, we find God's own people, again, the disobedient Israelites, I'll call them. You know, they was in and out with God and out with God, and very often God had to speak to them to bring them back in line. And Jeremiah, although we often call him the weeping prophet, he had enough to weep about. And God said to Jeremiah, this is what I want you to say to my people. And it's the third time I've had to tell them this. And this is what it says. Say to them, this is what the Lord says. When people fall down, do they not get up? When someone turns away, do they not return? Why then have these people turned away? Why does Jerusalem always turn away? They cling to deceit. They refuse to return. I have listened attentively, but they do not say what is right. None of them repent for the wickedness, save one of idol. Each pursues their own course, like a horse charging into battle. Even the stork in the sky knows her appointed season. The dove, the swift, and the thrush observe their times of migration. But my people do not know the requirements of the Lord. How can you say we are wise, for we have the Lord of the Lord, when actually the lying pen of the scribes has handled it falsely? The wise will be put to shame. They will be dismayed and trapped, since they have rejected the word of the Lord. What kind of wisdom do they have? Therefore I will give their wives to other men, and their fields to new owners, from the least to the greatest, all are greedy for gain, prophets and priests alike, all practice deceit. They dress the wounds of my people as though it were not serious. Peace, peace, they say, when there's no peace. Are they ashamed of the detestable conduct? No, they have no shame at all. They do not even know how to blush. So they will fall among the fallen. They will be brought down when they are punished, says the Lord. I will take away their armies, declares the Lord. There will be no grapes on the vine. There will be no figs on the tree. And the leaves will wither. What I have given them will be taken from them. We have hoped for peace, but no good has come. For a time of healing, but there is only terror. You who are my comforter in sorrow, my heart is faint within me. Listen to the cry of my people from a land far away. Is the Lord not in Zion? Is our king no longer there? Why have they aroused my anger with their images, with their worthless foreign idols? The harvest is past. The summer is gone. And the people said, we are not saved. Let's listen to the message from the band.
October 4, 2021, we remember by lots of people, not because of the way around scientific birthday, but for many people who work able to stand still Monday evening this week, Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, all of those things all stopped working for about 4 or 5 hours, the longest time it's ever been that available since it was introduced. I must admit, I did send a whole bunch of messages out just before that happened, and I was a little bit worried that everyone was ignoring it. But soon I realised it was something bigger than just my own personal messaging system was not working. But it made me think of this tune that we're going to share with you this morning. The verse, second and third verses say, "What to me are all the joys of earth? What to me is every sight I see? Save the sight of thee, O friend of mine, Jesus, thou art everything to me. Here I lay me at thy bleeding feet, deepest homage now I give to thee. Hear thy whisper of love within my soul, Jesus, thou art everything to me."
Thank you. morning these songs that are going to give God the glory. We want you to join in and praise the Lord. So the words will be on the wall, but when we get to the chorus, four of you there, if you want to join in and sing us, we give God the glory for great things He has done.
The August is past, The summer is, well, is it almost gone, or has it gone? Huh? Or have we had one this year? And we are not saved. We are not rescued. Their concern, however, was not about their salvation. It was actually about their own safety. They were not concerned about their salvation. It was about their satisfaction. And finally, their concern was about their self-righteousness. It was all based on self. Yet the message that was delivered to Jeremiah was, as I said, the third time that God had spoken to Judah and Israel. A message delivered on behalf of God, which was very much a message of salvation. But the people of Israel and Judah need to change. Remember, we believe that our salvation depends upon the continued obedient faith in God. And they hadn't. They lost their faith. And they turned away. And God said, you need to amend your ways. And we read through, if you want to read yourself, Jeremiah 7 and 8, the ways the people had turned away from God. The first thing they'd done, they started worshipping idols. Now, idols for each of us come in many different shapes and forms. When we place anything in front of God and worship that instead of worshipping God, that's an idol. And that was the first thing, that God wasn't happy with them. The second thing is they closed their ears to listening to what God had to say to them. Close their ears. The truth they had cast aside. Their sin was blatant. Jeremiah 7 said they had destroyed their own children. And they were in a state of backsliding. We don't need much of that today, do we? Backsliding, huh? Means to fall back, it's as simple as that. And these people had fallen back away from God. And because of it, they had become full of pride. And they had departed from the Lord and His word. And the Israelites said, as I've said, the harvest is past. The summer is ended. And their conclusion was, we are not saved. We are not saved. That's awful when we say what God has given to each of us. Salvation, as the subject just reminded, the vilest offender who truly believes that moment in Jesus, pardon received, and they said, the Lord has given us everything, and we are not saved. They were stuck in captivity, but they were not saved because of how they were choosing to live. And at that time, they were not prepared to change. Matthew 7 says this, not everyone that says unto the Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. But he that doeth the will of my Father. That's the answer. It is in the obedient faith that we remain in the state of salvation. But it goes on even to say, and then I will profess to them, I never knew you. That's all. I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. And the Israelites was in that state. As they were sitting, they were dejected. They were depressed. The season of hope, the harvest, is gone. The sunshine and the blessings of the summer is over. And suddenly the realization hits them, the reality of the fact that here they are in a foreign land, away from God, away from their beloved temple, away from everything that meant that they worshipped Christ in the right way. Their sin and their iniquity had separated them from their God. And then this terrible realization hits them, and they say, "We are not saved." You know, when you're as old as me, you will remember very often, and there was no shame, or people would come and say, "Carol, how's your soul?" Did they? "How's your soul?" And you see, they were interested not in how I was doing physically, but how I was doing spiritually. And there was a genuine concern about where their brothers and sisters would be spending their eternity. And very often they would say, "Are you saved? Are you being kept saved?" I'm going to try it some of these weeks. Yeah? I'm giving you warning. Imagine walking into the doctor's with a pain in your chest. You sit down, and the doctor says, "Well, it might be here this morning, I don't know." And the doctor says to you, "What's wrong?" Does he? That's if you can get in these days. And you say, "Well, I've had a bit of a pain, but I think I'm all right. Yes, I'm not going to worry about it." You go for tests, and the tests reveal another story. Four arteries are blocked up, and you still haven't a care in the world. And the doctor pleads with you, "Please, you need a bypass." But you just go on. Can you imagine the concern of the doctor? I'm not sure if there won't be one. But the foolishness of sinners, because the Saviour of men is more concerned about your soul than you are. We still live in the days of grace and opportunity, when we do have the chance to turn our lives around, where we can experience God's salvation plan for each of our lives. But the scriptures clearly tell us there will come a time when the harvest is truly past and the summer is gone, and we shall no longer be saved. The problem for the Israelites was not that they weren't concerned, they just wasn't prepared to amend their lifestyles. You know, God is not obliged to save any of us. Do you realize that? He's not obliged to save any of us. But the miracle of the gospel is that in grace and love, he gave his son for us, that we might be saved. After all the opportunities you've had, after all the other's hopes for you, it's sad to hear, "Not saved." You know, one day, the Lord will open the book of opportunities. All the prayers that have been prayed for you, all the harvest seasons of hope, and the summer of opportunities that you've all had, he will go down them, and I wonder where he'll find it. Only you can answer that, really. But would he find refused? Refuse. You know, pilot, don't you? He stood face to face with Jesus. And he washed his hands of him. He washed his hands of the Saviour who stood before him. Refused. You remember Judas? He heard the voice of Christ. He heard the teaching. And he had been a partaker of it. Yet he betrayed the Lord with a kiss for 30 pieces of silver. The price was the same. Refused. The Israelites were as good as asking, well, where is God? Where does he be? You're talking about a past year. Where is he? The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and God still hasn't come to our aid. And God replied to them, as he does to each of us this morning, you know why it hasn't happened? Because of your idols. Because of your foreign gods. Because of your sin. If you don't want me to forsake you, you've got to forsake them. The reason God hadn't penetrated their lives and their situation was because of their rebellious sinfulness. It was nothing to do with God. It was them. You won't let me in. That was their real captivity. And we are not saved. There was a man in the shipyard. And whenever anybody came up to him and said, can you give me the time? He would look at his watch and he would say, now is the day of salvation. And it takes minutes to wait. My friend, he said, God has given you another opportunity to get saved. Now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We need to remind ourselves as Christians that the day of salvation is swiftly drawing to a close. And whatever you think, according to the scriptures, I think we're in the last days. When we see the world in which we live, and the way the world is going, then the scripture says, look up and watch. For the day of salvation is swiftly drawing to a close. The Lord will return as he promised. I will come back. And then there will be no hope. You know, none of us can go back in time to our missed opportunities. And I'm sure we've all done it. We've all missed opportunities in our life. But we can go forward with God. We can turn those words around which say, the harvest is past, the summer is gone, and I am saved. Hallelujah. You see, as I said at the start, salvation belongs to God. For each of our lives are ruled by choice. And if somebody was here this morning and I said to him, it's all to do with choices, I'd say, that's you and your choices, huh? And he would laugh. But salvation belongs to our God. For our lives are ruled by our own choices that we make. The scriptures clearly say we cannot walk with God and walk with the world. Can't happen. Because you'll be walking in two directions. You cannot walk with God and walk with the world. You cannot serve God and mammon together. Every day, without an alloys, we are faced with choice. Whether you like it or not, choice. And the scripture says, we are to choose every day who we are to serve. Choose this day who you will serve. And today is a day of choice. And perhaps you know where you are in the Lord. And we need to just consider for a few moments just where we really are with Him. Because if we want the Lord to bless us, then we have to do His will. There's no other way. We have to do His will, and then He will bless us. So we're going to sing, there's quite a few verses for this one. Six verses. But it's a familiar song that was often used at many of the campaigns of Billy Graham. Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood will shed for me, and that thou bidst me unto thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Let's sing the song straight away.
Thank you.
Lord, how often we kid you out of our lives. We know how easy it is to sin, and we cannot save ourselves. How often we close the door when we hear you knocking. By faith we receive your grace and mercy that leads us to salvation and keeps us in your salvation. Help us to trust you daily as our Lord and our Saviour. Thank you for coming to our earth. We believe you are the Son of God who died on the cross for our sins and rose from the dead on the third day. Thank you for bearing our sins and giving us the gift of eternal life. We believe your words are true, and one day the harvest will be past and the sun will be gone. Until that day, keep us faithful, Lord, our friend and our Saviour. Our final hymn says, now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. Let's stand and sing the song straight. Spirit keep us warm and safe in our walk with God. during this week. Amen.